Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim. It's my privilege to welcome you to this series on science from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, history, science, and the soul in Islam. Inshallah, today's presentation is on the historical evolution of the madrasa, a subject matter that is of interest to a large number of people in the world, because the madrasa has been in the news at least since the beginning of the Taliban in Afghanistan. By way of introduction, I want to share with you that the instructions in schools can be divided into 7 broad categories. One is the Quran and the Sunnah of the Prophet. That is a given. This is in Islamic religious schools. The second one, and you hear about it again and again, is akhlaq, which can be translated to mean character or ethics. The third one is tazkiyatun nafs, commonly known as Sufism, but the word in the Quran is tazkiyah, the purification of the heart. Then you have a broad category of subjects related to languages, language, grammar, debates, elocution. All of this can be grouped together and presented as a unified discipline related to languages. Then you have another broad category of disciplines related to mathematics. That would be, in the beginning, arithmetic, geometry, and I'll go into different kinds of geometry a little bit, because it will help us understand the contributions of the Muslims throughout the ages. Astronomy, astrology for a while. These subjects are related, so let's put them all together in the mathematics column as a bundle of disciplines related to mathematics. Then you have law, civics, history, and politics. For instance, in America, we need to know the laws. And this has been true throughout history too. No matter where you live, you must know the law of the land where you live. You must know how the body politic works. Civics. How do people relate to each other? What is the structure? What are the constraints of the structure? And these change from time to time. And depending on the structure, we need to understand how education fits within that structure. Either it supports it, or there is a sense of tension with the existing structure. Then the last item would be skills, which is something that we all develop. We become engineers, doctors, architects, whatnot. These are skills that enable us to make a living. Alhamdulillah. Now, I'm presenting it in a simplified format, because as we go into the evolution of the madrasa, we'll see how gradually the various disciplines have gotten constrained. It's as if Islamic civilization developed glaucoma. Some of you are doctors, learned doctors. You know what happens in most forms of glaucoma. You have the vision, and gradually it falls upon itself. You lose your peripheral vision until, towards the end, all you see is the central vision, and that too finally disappears. It's as if Islamic civilization developed glaucoma and gradually lost its vision. And this classification will help us understand, because the subject matter is broad. All of these subject matters are very broad. What is presented here is a method of understanding. It's didactic. It's a method of teaching, a method of simplification, so that we can lock in the basic concepts. What has happened in this day and age, in our day and age, is that the skills, the acquisition of skills, becoming an engineer, a doctor, architect, that has taken the preponderant position in civilization. People focus on that, to the exclusion of all other disciplines. And inshallah, we'll ask ourselves towards the end of the presentation as to what we need to do here in America to renew our faith in accordance with the teachings of the Quran and the Sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Last week, we presented a paradigm consisting of 7 different archetypes. And there was a good question from the floor, why 7, why not more? Yes, it's again a didactic method, a method of teaching that enables us to lock in the major bends in Islamic history. And we said the first bend was after the passing away of our Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and that was the period from 632 to the year 765, wherein we see the emergence of the visionary. These were the people who learned directly from the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and they passed on what they had learned to people as far away as Central Asia and Europe and North Africa and parts of India. Then we said the second period was from 765 to 847 of the Common Era. This was the age of reason, the rationalists. They're called in Islam the Mu'tazilites. And we also covered why it was that reason collapsed in Islam. It collapsed because those who are the practitioners of reason did not understand the limits of reason. Reason is a noble faculty. Nothing in Allah's creation except the heart has the capability of reason. It can reach even up to the footsteps of the heavens. However, it has its limits, it has its assumptions. And especially in this day and age, when people say, can we apply reason to faith? Be careful. Be very careful, because you must understand what the limits of reason are before you take it as a tool to try to understand some other subject. It is like, for instance, if you want to measure the temperature at the center of the sun, our sun up there, you don't go up there with a ruler made of a stick. You cannot do it. It has its limits. So they fell flat on their faces. Then, in the late Abbasid period, after the collapse of the rationalists, emerged the integrators, the Hakims, Al-Hakims, people who pulled together different fields of knowledge, all the fields of knowledge that I'm outlining here briefly. And they were called the Al-Hakim, the people of wisdom. And what is wisdom? There is no definition for wisdom. It is an attribute of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It's a name of Allah. Allah is the wise one. So, since all the Asma'ul Husna connote both a transcendent being, namely a name, an attribute, and an adverb. So when we say Asma'ul Husna, please remember that. It's a name, an attribute, and an adverb. That is the beauty of the Quranic language. What is wisdom? We don't know. People define it in different ways. Maybe a judicious application of what we know to the problems at hand. Why do we say that Solomon was a wise man? Similarly, we can ask ourselves, what is the wise thing to do for Muslims in America today? Wisdom is a gift from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He gives it to whom He pleases. Sometimes a child may be wise, and a grown-up man may be unwise. That was the age of wisdom. That was the flowering of science in the Islamic age. that lasted until the invasion of the Mongols in the 13th century, and until, to put a date on it, the destruction of Baghdad in the year 1258, that brought an end to what we call the classical Islamic civilization. Then there was a period of convulsion. Things did not settle down because everything, all the way from Samarkand and Bukhara to the outskirts of Jerusalem, had been destroyed. The ulama disappeared, libraries burned, dams destroyed. The ulama, they were not there. So in this kind of a situation, it was the spirituality of Islam that came to the rescue of the Islamic peoples. The awliya Allah, it's as if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had laid the foundation for the awliya Allah, because some of the greatest ones, such as Sayyidina Abdul Khalil Jilani, appeared in the previous century, in the 12th century. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had laid the foundation so that in the 13th century you see the flowering of Islamic spirituality. So what the Mongols could not destroy was the spirit of Islam. And it was these people, the awliya Allah, who converted the Mongols, even as early as 1221. 1219 was the year Genghis Khan invaded Central Asia and followed the Muslim armies all the way to the Indus River, which is today in Pakistan. In 1221, 2 years after the onslaught, the awliya Allah briefed Genghis Khan about Islam as he was going back to Karakoram, which was the capital of the Mongols. So it was these awliya Allah and the period of the awliya. And some people ask me, I'll take a digression in here. People in this day and age want to have a definition for everything. Who is a wali, they ask me? Who are the awliya Allah? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala defines awliya Allah in the Quran. Ala awliya Allahi, wa la khawfun alayhim, wa la hum yahzanun. See, awliya Allah are those who are blessed with ma'rifah. And then people will ask, what is ma'rifah? I'll define this some other time, inshallah. But you see, anybody can aspire to be a wali. You can aspire to be a wali. You can aspire to be a wali. You can aspire to be a wali. Depending on the blessing from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we get close to Allah. Except that when we get close to Allah, we don't say, Allah loves me. We don't say, I'm close to Allah. Never say that. Because if you say, I love Allah, Allah will test you and you cannot pass the test. Say that Allah loves me, not I love Allah. Don't say I love Allah. Say Allah loves me. Awliya Allah are those who have attained ma'rifah, the inner knowledge of the Sharia. And they're close to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They're friends of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's grace surrounds them inside and out. Not outside in, not inside out, inside and out, both ways. That was the period of awliya Allah. That lasted till the year 1684. Very important date. It's amazing how, when you study history, certain dates stand out. What happened in the year 1684? Three things. I think I mentioned it the last time. One, Sir Isaac Newton published his book, The Newton's Laws of Motion, 1683, 1684. 1684 was the year the Turkish armies were repelled from the second siege of Vienna, receded towards Hungary and Yugoslavia, all the way to the Balkans. And it was also the year in the Mughal Empire when Aurangzeb promulgated the Futuwat-e Alamgiri. You see, Islamic civilization took a turn from Taqwa to Fatwa, 1684. It's amazing how the issue, the Islamic civilization has taken a turn because of events in the subcontinent. When you look at the subcontinent today, it's so poor. And we say, well, India, Pakistan, Bangladesh, they're poor. No, but in the 17th century, the Indian subcontinent, as ruled by Aurangzeb, was the richest country in the world. accounting for 30% of the GDP of the world. By far the richest, richer than China, richer than all of the Ottoman Empire, richer than all of Europe put together. It was a very rich country, very powerful country. So the events in the subcontinent had a profound effect on Islamic civilization. And Futuhat-e Aramgiri changed the direction of Islamic civilization from taqwa, that is, tazkiyatun nafs, to fatwa. And thereafter we see the emergence of Sheikh Abdul Wahhab of Saudi Arabia. At that time it was Arabia. And Usman Danfodio in Nigeria. All of these were exponents of the exoteric aspects of Islam. It was this exoteric dimension of Islam that came into conflict with a resurgent Europe, which had consolidated its power through the emergence of the joint stock company. They had figured out how to pool the resources of people through the joint stock company so that they could challenge other civilizations. And it's also not commonly appreciated that India was the first great non-Western civilization to fall to the West. And it was using the resources of India that England, for sure, and as satellite empires, the Dutch Empire and the French Empire, managed to then go on colonize Indonesia, Vietnam, and much of Asia, and then later Africa. So that was the age of colonialism. The colonists did not have any use for the kind of instruction that was being imparted before, so they changed. We'll cover it in a minute. And then, after the age of colonialism, comes the modern period. The modern period, the technological period. The period wherein the only limit to human progress is the speed of light and our capacity to absorb change. Some way to look at it. We live in it. So now, you see, we covered the different types of archetypes that we have, the emergence of them, and different periods in Islamic history. Now, let's go back to the madrasa. The madrasa also. First of all, what is madrasa? It comes from the word darasa, which means to teach. Madrasa is a place where you teach. It is not something you read in the newspapers about Afghanistan or northwestern Pakistan. Do not be drawn into the vocabulary that is a passing vocabulary in the newspapers. Madrasa is a beautiful word. It comes from the word darasa, to teach. Another word is maktab. But anyway, let's go back to the madrasa. It also shows seven discrete stages in its evolution. Corresponding to the seven discrete stages that I have described for the emergence of the archetypes. And one way to look at it is not chronologically. That is easy. We can start from the time of the Prophet ﷺ, that is after his death, because his time was special. We're not going to get into it. That would require many lectures by itself. But after him. And then go on, and the corresponding syllabus in the various different stages. What we'll do instead is sort of titillate a little bit. We'll have a little fun with it. When you study the Quran, you'll come across this. When I was doing the translation of the Quran, it's amazing. Every ayah has a center of gravity. It's amazing. Every surah has a center of gravity. The Quran has a center of gravity. The ones who are endowed with inner knowledge look for the center of gravity. For instance, in Surah Yasin, Salamun Qawlan Mir Rabbir Rahim. That's the center of gravity of Surah Yasin. Similarly, we look for the center of gravity of the madrasa. And that center of gravity is around the year 1190. Why 1190? It was a very fascinating period in history. 1190, At that time, the Islamic world was divided into two broad camps, the Fatimids, who controlled Egypt and Syria, and most of Hejaz and North Africa, and the Abbasids, who controlled Baghdad and the eastern part of the Islamic world. And the two were locked in combat for the control of Baghdad. The Buyuds from the southern portion of Iraq contested with the Seljuks for the control of Baghdad. This is, I'm talking about, around the year 1190. Finally, the Seljuks were triumphant, the Turks. And Malik Shah, the Seljuk emperor, appointed Nizam al-Mulk. The word Nizam, we'll talk about the Nizamiya syllabus as we go into it. Nizam meaning an administrator. I don't know his exact name here, I'm not written it down, but his title was Nizam al-Mulk. By far, one of the best administrators produced by Islamic history after Umar radiallahu anhu. One of the best. He managed to rationalize tax collection. He furthered agriculture, encouraged it, trade, because the Fatimids controlled Egypt and trade between Europe and India had been cut off by the Fatimids. It's a side comment. Since the trade was cut off, there was not much money in Baghdad. And that was the reason why, for instance, Mahmud of Ghazna had to invade India, not because he hated the Hindus. That's because the money that used to come to the Islamic Empire through the trade between Europe and India and the Far East was cut off by the Fatimids. And they needed money. So he was after money. Anyway, coming back to Nizam al-Mulk, he was a great administrator. One of the greatest things he did was to establish a university in Baghdad. There were other universities. Remember, the first university that was established in the world was in the 8th century by a lady in Sijil Masr. First university in the world, a lady, a woman, established a university. And people say, well, women are held back in Islam, women are backward in Islam. Get to know your history, especially ladies. Get to know the names of the sovereigns, women sovereigns, and what they did. And inshallah, we'll go into Razia Sultana and so on. The first university in all of humankind, great one, established by a lady in North Africa. Nizam al-Mulk established a college in Baghdad. Now, why is that important? You see, we think of Baghdad, we think of Khaira, that's Cairo, and blurry-eyed. The Fatimids and the Abbasids had a tug of war, not just for the control of territory, but also for the control of the hearts of the Muslims. The Al-Azhar University, established in the year 969 by the Fatimids. Great university. But initially, it was a propaganda center for the Seveners, for the Fatimids. They wanted to convert Sunni Islam to the Seveners. And the Da'is were very active. They were not successful. Egypt remained Sunni. So did North Africa, except for places in Lebanon. But that's another story. So the establishment of a college in Baghdad was not only to teach the people, but also as a counter-propaganda center against the Fatimids. If you read Imam al-Ghazali carefully, great man, perhaps the most influential man in Islamic history, Imam al-Ghazali, great man. He brought tasawwuf within the fold of Orthodox Islam. Every one of his books is a veritable treasure, but he was also involved in polemics with the Seveners, with the Fatimids. Many of his writings, you read carefully, he shows, as he puts it, the errors, what is wrong with the Fatimids. And he was also involved in a dialectic or a debate with the rationalists, people of reason. And I'll share with you a thought. It's taken me a long time to crystallize it. Even Imam Al-Ghazali went too far. Some of these comments I'm going off on a side because my subject matter is the madrasa. But there's so much in here to share. They are important thoughts. Imam Al-Ghazali also went too far in his dialectic with the rationalists when he postulated that there was no such thing as before and after. That events happen, cause and effect happen simultaneously. Mathematically, that's absurd. Nothing happens simultaneously. No matter how small a time, it does take a finite amount of time for an event to take place. I don't have to emphasize this because there are so many scholars here, professors, teachers, imams. Think about it. But to assert, not only as Al-Ash'ari did, that time moves in discrete steps, that was an assumption. But on top of it, to assert that cause and effect do not exist, that they happen simultaneously, was a statement that is mathematically not correct. That had so much of an impact on the Islamic world. So much so that he defeated rationalism. Rationalism disappeared in the Islamic world after that. It started, the decline started with the Mu'tazilites, and the final blow was through the writings of Al-Ghazali. Coming back to the madrasa, it was a great madrasa. It attracted the madrasa that was founded in Baghdad by Nizam al-Mulk, was the greatest school of learning in the world in the 12th century. Imam al-Ghazali taught there as a professor, and so did so many other great ulama. And the fact that Imam al-Ghazali, after a while, gave up the professorship and went off, that's another story. In any case, the syllabus that was used in the Nizamiya College was a very comprehensive syllabus. And it included all of the seven disciplines that I outlined for you. Namely, it taught the Quran, the seerah of the Prophet, the Sunnah of the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. It taught akhlaq and tazkiyah and languages and mathematics, the arithmetic that they knew those days. Law, civics, history, politics, and also skills, so that people could make a living. Very comprehensive syllabus. It's like the complete rainbow. Then, after the destruction of Baghdad, that syllabus disappeared because the universities themselves disappeared. And what was taught after that, that is, for a couple of hundred years, down to the time of the Timurid invasions, 1258 to 1402 and so on, a period of great convulsions in the Islamic world, was primarily in addition to the Quran and the Sunnah of the Prophet, because without the Quran there is no Islam. Quran and Sunnah of the Prophet, tazkiyat al-nafs, so-called Sufism. See, the word Sufism is a historical word. It is not in the Quran. The Prophet was an embodiment of spirituality. The spirituality of the Prophet was inculcated, imbibed by the Sahaba. And later, it took on the word tasawwuf. It has multiple meanings. One of the meanings is that it comes from the word saf, meaning to cleanse. Another meaning is that Ashab al-Safa, the people who stood in a line, these were the people who used to wait for the Prophet ﷺ, waiting for him to come out of the house so that they would follow around and do exactly what he did. But the commonly accepted meaning is that it refers to suf, meaning the wool. That was the cloak that the Prophet ﷺ wore, and it was woven by the hands of Fatima al-Zahra. So the word tasawwuf or Sufi connotes the hand of Fatima al-Zahra. And those who are initiated into tasawwuf will tell you many, many stories about dreams or experiences that they've had with the appearance of Fatima al-Zahra. That's the connection. In any case, what was taught was, in addition to the Quran and Sunnah of the Prophet, primarily the discipline of tasawwuf. And the institutions wherein this instruction was given was called the Zawiya. Very important institution. Then when the Mongols became Muslim themselves, the Zawiya gradually took on the character of a school or a madrasa. And they started to teach, in addition to these two disciplines, akhlaq and skills. Why akhlaq? Good reason. All of these have historical reasons. Because in order to teach the disciplines of fiqh or the disciplines of sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, you must have teachers. If you don't have a teacher, you cannot teach physics. If a great institution like Caltech or MIT does not produce good physicists, you cannot have institutions that teach physics because you don't have instructors, you don't have the professors, you don't have the teachers. Since the institutions were destroyed, there was no production of teachers that could teach the sciences of fiqh and the sunnah of the Prophet. You had to go back to Khaira. Khaira was not destroyed. India was not destroyed, but India was still in its infancy, Islam in India. So they fell back upon akhlaq, which is ethics. So important. These ideas are very important for us in America. Ethics, akhlaq. Very important. And there were many great schools of akhlaq. One of the greatest of the writings that is commonly known is Akhlaq al-Nasiri, that was written by Nasiruddin al-Tusi in the year 1273. I tried to get a copy of it. I was told by Professor Sayyid Hussain Nasr that's available at Harvard. I was not able to put my hands on it. Some people said it's available, but if you can, read it. It was the first consistent, coherent exposition of the discipline of akhlaq in Islamic history by a man who was at the same time a great scientist, that is Nasiruddin al-Tusi. So this was the akhlaqi school that produced the three great dynasties of the Middle Ages. The great Mughals of India, the Safavids of Iran, and the Ottoman Empire. In all of these, you'll find, when you look at the syllabus in all of these, akhlaq occupies a very important place, the teaching of akhlaq. Once again, the reason is the dearth of good teachers. Whereas in the Arabic-speaking world, the Sunnah of the Prophet and the sciences of the Hadith have always occupied a preponderant position. Even now, for instance, even in Islamic centers, I'm going to expand a little bit and apply it to our contemporary. If you work in responsible positions in our Islamic centers, even in North America, and you get people from the Arabic-speaking world, and I will call the personalized word, which includes not just Persia, but Pakistan, India, Central Asia, and to a certain extent the Far East, you'll find that the Arabic-speaking people have a great emphasis on the Sunnah of the Prophet and the Hadith. Whereas people from the subcontinent have more of an emphasis on tazkiyah. Until recent times, things have changed recently. Tazkiyah, or tasawwuf, or akhlaq. This is the historical reason for that difference in emphasis. And hopefully, if people understand where it comes from, there won't be any conflict. But people don't understand it, therefore they misunderstand it. All three of these great dynasties that flourished from the beginning of the 16th century until the end of the 18th century, 17th century, emphasize akhlaq. And then, as I pointed out earlier, through the Futuwat-e Alamgiri, which had an enormous impact, not just in India, Pakistan, Bangladesh, and Afghanistan, which was the Mughal Empire, but also in the Ottoman Empire, and by inference, also in the Safavid Empire. The center of gravity of intellectual thought in Islam moved from there onto the observances. That's the exoteric Islam. What is important is how to wash your hands. What kind of punishment should people have? Even there, the Futuwat-e Alamgiri left a great deal to be desired, because the Futuwat, if you read it carefully, prescribes different punishments for people depending on where you are in the hierarchy. If you're a nobleman, it prescribes a different punishment than if you are a man on the street. It had a great impact. And Islamic civilization moved in that direction. Then if you look at the syllabus, this is the time when the Europeans are now beginning to colonize. They first took over the trade because the Muslims had neglected naval technology. This is the time when Europe's ascendancy is paramount. You find that Islamic civilization, in terms of its madrasas, is emphasizing the observances of the Sharia more so than the inner aspect of the Sharia. Sharia has two dimensions. It has a taste and it has an observance. Those who have the presence of Allah in their heart have the taste of Sharia. Those who observe it, observe it. You can see it when you go for Hajj. Some people bring a checklist. Did I do this? Did I do this? And then last checklist, I'm a Haji. But some people have tears in their eyes. You can see that. Even prayers, you can see that. So you can see Islamic civilization gradually lost its foothold onto its strength in the area of spirituality. Then as the Europeans gained ascendancy, the Europeans, as they colonized, had no use for the local people to learn such things as technology or science or philosophy. What they needed was people who had the ability to add things, accountancy, to manage their vast administrative bureaucracies. So gradually the institution, the madrasa institution, died out because the Europeans did not want the kind of education that would be useless for them to manage their vast empires. They introduced such things as accounting, which was very important for them. Some administration at the lower levels was important for them. No science, no mathematics. And you can see what happened to the Muslims. And it also happened to the other civilizations too. Hindus and Sikhs and Buddhists also went through this. They lost what they had, and instead they did not gain anything. That brings us to the latter part of the 19th century, the reawakening, if you will. You have people like Muhammad Abdul of Egypt and Allama Iqbal of Pakistan, who thought through this process and tried to offer solutions, not just to the process of education and what we should learn, but to somehow modify the way Muslims looked upon themselves and upon the West. That brings us to the modern age today. In America, for instance, the question before us is, what do we teach our children? Big question. What do we teach them? I would submit that we go back to the seven disciplines that I outlined and arrange them in a hierarchy. It is true in this competitive age today, in order to make a living, you have to be the best of the best in your field. Otherwise, you cannot make a living. So that is the skills area. However, the question before us is, that is like a pillar. What should be the foundation of that pillar? And I would submit to you that foundation should have two different levels. At the basic level should be the teaching of the Quran and the Sunnah of the Prophet. No Quran, no Islam. I appeal to you. I appeal to everyone. Every man, woman, and child must read the Quran. And those of you who are able to do so, attempt a translation of Surah Al-Baqarah. Everyone should try to do that. Granted, you may not be successful, but you will learn. You will learn the basics, what is in the Quran. So that when somebody recites the Quran, somebody talks to you, you understand it. So that's the foundation. And the other part of the foundation is tazkiyah. Tazkiyah takes us to your heart. Universities mold our minds. A great sheikh molds your heart. That's the difference between a professor and a sheikh. Nowadays we use the word sheikh rather loosely. But a true sheikh, he transforms or she transforms your heart so that the presence of Allah is always with you, inside of you. And when the heart is pure, as the tradition of our Prophet Muhammad says, that everything is pure. That's tazkiyah. And the other thing we have to teach, this is the basics. Three subjects that are basic. Quran, the Quranic sciences, tazkiyah, and akhlaq. When character is lost, everything is lost. Especially in this day and age. Material civilization, anything goes. Anything goes. Teach our children these three basic subjects when they're young, while at the same time teaching the second level. The second level consists of languages, mathematics, history, and law. Language is the key to success in modern life. Do teach the children how to speak, how to write, how to communicate, how to talk, how to debate. A person who can talk well is halfway there in terms of being successful in his life, no matter what he does, no matter what she does. And mathematics. People are afraid of mathematics. Teach them the basics. Languages, mathematics. That's the second level of the structure. And something about the law, the civics, what are your rights and responsibilities within the Constitution of the United States. They should know the rights and responsibilities. And then upon that, build this edifice of skills. Be not just a doctor, be the greatest doctor. Be not just an engineer, but the greatest engineer. Not just a businessman, but the greatest businessman. Make $1 billion, alhamdulillah. As did Imam Abu Hanifa, he was a very rich man. Abu Bakr Siddiq, he was a very rich man. Be successful, but build this structure, one on top of the other. Because history teaches us that these are the disciplines that enabled the Muslims at one time to be where they were, at the top of the world. These were the disciplines that enabled the Muslims to build the Taj Mahal. These were the disciplines that enabled the Muslims to build the Badshahi Mosque in Lahore, or the Jamia Masjid in Delhi, or the Registan in Samarkand, or the Blue Mosque in Istanbul. Ask yourself, can you do it today? I'll just share the following experience, then we'll go to questions and answers. About 15 years ago, I was just trying to build an Eidgah near Bangalore. It was a very subtle design, combining space age concepts with traditional designs. And I wanted to build it out of stones. And I looked around, and no matter how much I looked, I could not find the craftsmen who were able to carve the stones and build it in the fashion. After attempting 3 or 4 times, I gave up. Finally, it was built out of bricks, and even the bricks were defective. Can we build a Taj Mahal today? Suppose we gave $1 billion to Pakistan, or India, or Bangladesh, or Afghanistan. I would submit that it would be very difficult. Because the base is not there. I'll give you another example. People think of calligraphy. So it's a beautiful calligraphy. Do you know what goes into making a person a good calligrapher? First, they work on his physique. They exercise their special and specific exercises for the hand and the fingers so that they become pliable and strong and resilient. And then they teach them how to hold the pen and how to get the ink on the page. Quality, training, they are not there. Because the instruction and the training that we receive is flawed. We need to get back to it. So in America, as we train our children, let's keep the lessons of history in mind and teach our children these disciplines, make them the best that they can be, but always on a foundation of a knowledge of the Quran, the seerah of the Prophet, the basis of akhlaq, good character, tazkiyah, the presence of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the heart, because when he's not there, you can build a building, but you cannot build an architecture. You can build a structure, but you cannot build a Taj Mahal. It comes from within. And languages. Let's know how to talk, how to speak, how to present. Mathematics and our rights and responsibilities. So that's our presentation today. I thank you. If there are any errors, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgive me. If I said something right, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgive me. I wanted to share with you a couple of items, if I may. People were waiting for the Quran. 1,600 copies have appeared at the MCC now. We have them. There were 5,000 copies printed and 3,400 have been sold out already. I made sure that we got 1,600. And there with MCC, please talk to Brother Asif. And you know, this is fi sabilillah, but if somebody wants to contribute $5-6 per copy or something, please give it to MCC or to the American Institute that published it. That's one. The other thing is, people ask me copies of these presentations. Now, several comments. One, first it appeared as a series of publications in New York. There was a magazine in the 90s. A good friend of mine, Muhammad Munim, published them, so they were available at that time. And then on the internet, many of these essays have been there for, well, over 4 years now. And now I've had more than 1.8 million hits. So you don't have to spend any money. However, if you like to get a book, here's the history. The book has been translated into Urdu and Farsi. First, the first one to take a stab at publishing was Suhail Academy in Lahore, Pakistan. God bless him. He did a wonderful job, a labor of love. So much so, the book was sold out even before he brought it out. And then, as things happen in Pakistan these days, Suhail Academy has disappeared. So that's the story. However, later the American Institute of Islamic History and Culture published it in the United States. This is available through the publisher. Now, if people do want a copy, for instance, I get discounts as the author, and each copy with the what we pay UPS costs $24 times 2 is 48, but whatever discount I get from the publisher, it will come to about $37 for both of them, if you want them, provided we have 5 requests for it. If not, alhamdulillah, they are available. So with that, let me listen to the comments that you have to make. Yes.
First of all, I have found those books on Amazon.com, and I've also found them on the Barnes & Noble site, so you don't have to go to the publisher.
What's the title?
It's called Islam in Global History.
And all of them?
Volume 1 and Volume 2. And if there's interest, let me know. I will get you a good price.
I think, you know, anybody who wants, let's give the name so that, you know, we know we have to buy 10 sets or 15 sets or something like that. Then, you know, that would be, I don't want to trouble him too much, but, you know, let's give the name.
Any questions, comments on the madrasa or the method of teaching or about teaching our children in America?
Yeah, in the beginning you were going to tell us the development of the madrasa through the 7 different stages, and instead you focus on what was the height, and if you could show how it progressed to that and where we are today.
Well, if you examine the Nizamiya syllabus, which was comprehensive, and plot it chronologically, you will see one area or the other gradually fall off. It would be a good way to present it. You start with the circle and the sectors. I did this at home just having some fun, and one of the youngsters, the younger son of Brother Hassani, came in and said, "Oh, I understand it. We did it in school like this." So if you plot it like this and divide it into 7 sectors and have 7 different circles, if you would, going forwards from the Nizamiya syllabus to the so-called Nizamiya syllabus today, and going backwards to the time of the passing of our Prophet ﷺ, you'll learn a great deal. It's like a full rainbow gradually losing its colors because of historical events and the interference of rulers like Aurangzeb and the appearance of people like Sheikh Abdul Wahhab. You'll see how the circle after a while becomes just a line, a single line.
So like in Bangladesh there is a madrasa called Nizamiya Madrasa.
Yeah, the same. Well, they call it Nizamiya. You see, when you go to madrasas in India, you know, for instance, there are like, I forget, I used to know 225,000 madrasas. Every masjid has a madrasa. So when you go to a madrasa, they treat you with great respect, they offer you tea, say, "We follow the Nizamiya syllabus." What they're talking about is the origin of the Nizamiya syllabus. I presented to you where the word Nizamiya comes from. That's the origin of it. Gradually, the Nizamiya syllabus lost its wings, lost its legs, it lost its feathers, and all you have left is Hifz al-Quran and some idea about the Usul al-Fiqh, the dimensions. We all know that. And then they become alims and fazils in that. But it is not the Nizamiya syllabus. It is a residual, what is left over, of what used to be the most comprehensive syllabus in the whole world in the year 1190. For instance, Imam al-Ghazali, yes.
And who is the woman you mentioned? Like the lady, I mean, woman who established the first.
Gosh, I used to know my age.
How in Morocco?
Yes, right? Name.
Fatima al-Fihriya.
Oh, Fatima.
Yes.
Yeah, oh. Her name is Fatima al-Fihriya.
Fatima al-Fihriya, thank you so much. Okay. At 77, can work hard.
Morocco.
Yes, there was a common question. Brother Hassan?
No, 2 minutes.
Yes. Question?
2 minutes.
2 minutes. Yes.
I need a clarification, if you don't mind. So you said the third thing that changed in 1684 was Aurangzeb's book?
Yeah, not book. This was promulgation. Aurangzeb was the mighty emperor. He brought in scholars from Saudi Arabia, from Iran, from India, and from the Ottoman Empire. And these people worked on the futuwat, the edicts, for almost 10 years, and they came up with this compilation called Futuwate Alamgiri. That's what it was.
Recording right here.
Any other comment? Suggestion? The rationalists were during the first phase of the Abbasid period, starting with the year 765 till the year 846. They were in the favor of the Abbasid Khalifas, like Harun, Mamun. They were all rationalists. Now, rationalism did not die out. It sort of got subsumed, because in the 14th century, we find the appearance of the Mu'tazilites in the Tughlaq courts of Delhi. They were very active there. Muhammad bin Tughlaq was a rationalist. And there are many stories about the conflict between the rationalists, the traditionalists, and the Sufis in his court. Thank you very much. We really appreciate it.